Okay, so today we're doing a site model of the Outpost project, and I thought I'd just show you kind of my process here. So our first step is to determine the scale of the model, and I'm here at the computer because I'm going to be printing out a template that we're going to use to cut our contours and size our model base from. Scale is going to be determined by how you want to actually use the model. For this model, we're going to use it as a design tool. It needs to be large enough to look at roof forms, large enough to look at its relationship to the topography, but not so large that we have to invest a lot of detail and time and materials in building something that's really large. We want to be able to quickly iterate. So just from experience, I know it's going to be somewhere between 1/16 of an inch equals a foot and 1/4 of an inch equals a foot. Now, 1/4 would be a really large model, too much detail. I'm not ready to make all the decisions that building a model that large would require. Whereas 1/16 of an inch, it's really tiny, so really not a useful design tool for me. So I'm going to go somewhere in between there, and I've chosen 3/32 of an inch equals a foot. Now, the other advantage to this is that the cork layers that I'm going to use for the model base, for the contours, that's also 3/32 of an inch thick. So as I'm building up the contours of the topography, I know for every layer, I'm gonna be looking at a 1 vertical foot increment here. Now we'll move into the computer because I wanna make a base template that I can use to start cutting all these contours with. So if you didn't catch the first video, make sure you catch that. But we basically wandered around this large property. It's about 80 acres, and we settled on this as the building site. We had a little chat sitting out on site here and looking out over the water. And we flagged this as a GPS coordinate, and we've overlaid that on the topography model. The topography model shows the ocean, shows where our setback is, and I'm gonna be using this to flag that on our model. And this is our sort of general ideal building spot here. I'm just gonna print this out at 24 by 36. So this is 24 inches, this is 36 inches. I know I wanna capture some of the ocean in here. The contours are all shown here in yellow. So I'm gonna print this out at 24 by 36. And I'm gonna use this as a gauge to say, roughly I want the site to be in the center here. And then I'm gonna look and see what size we actually want this to be. Where do we want to clip the site model in here? And we'll talk about that next. Okay, so let's print this out. Knowing in general where you want to build on the site is helpful in determining how large you're going to make this base. Couple of factors come into play here. Number one is how much context you want surrounding the site. So I know in general, the size of the house here, when we build a model at this scale, it's gonna be about this large, right? So I want some space to either side of it, but probably not too much because each one of these lines represents 2 vertical feet. So that's 2 layers of the thickness of cork that I have. So this is probably close to 60 layers together. So that's a lot of cork. So I wanna kind of minimize that. The other thing to think about here is what you wanna study. So I wanna study the approach here. So I know I wanna capture some of this zone. So lengthwise, this looks about right because I wanna show where the ocean is. I wanna show how this slope is impacted, how far back the house is. I wanna be able to model some of the vegetation. But equally, I want to pay attention to the materials that I'm using. So I know the roll of cork that I have is 48 inches wide. So I want to choose some module that's going to correlate with that. Now, I could choose 24 inches wide, which would be the full width of this. But I don't know if the house is this large. I just don't need that much space to either side. I actually know some of this is unbuildable. So that's not going to help me that much. I think if I go to a 16 inch wide model, that would allow me to get 3 pieces out of the 4-foot-wide roll of cork. So that's very material efficient. So I think that zone is going to kind of run right centered on this ideal building spot right in here. Cork layers are cut, step one. So once I have all the layers cut, next step is to come up with a base. I've got 1/2 inch homosote here, and this is just gonna serve as a solid platform to build up the contours on top of. So I've got my template sheet here, and I've labeled some of the contours, the elevations here. This represents the water's edge. This will represent the ocean, the water. And we always start with the lowest contour, so we'll start building up from this point forward. We don't work from the top down where the smallest ones are. We work from the largest ones up. So we've got our base, and I'll just go ahead and start cutting. Make our first cut. Doesn't have to be completely precise. This is a rocky shoreline, so having kind of some uneven or more jagged cuts seems appropriate. Make sure you always keep a sharp blade. This one looks like it's not as sharp as it could have been. That's our first contour. You're always gonna save the scraps so we can use those later on. So contour number two. Cork is really forgiving in terms of how you're cutting with it. So let's stop and take a moment here. I'm getting to the top layers. It's been probably about 45 minutes that I've been cutting, so not too bad. But now we're at contour 55. So actually just noticed that 54 comes in along here and 55 comes in along here too. So this topography, there's this kind of ridge that's running like this, and then there's a lower piece that kind of ducks in here. Okay, so we're at contour 55. So I know 55 has to be cut out of this contour, but I also know that I missed a little bit on 54. So I need to go back to 54. That's the one I just cut. I need to line up that edge, and then I need to cut 54 out. The dark dashed lines are what I received from the survey, and then the pencil lines I interpolated between that. The dark black lines represent a 2-foot contour. This cork is the thickness of 1 foot. So I needed to interpolate between the two. So that's all I did. So with gluing, I'm just gonna start in the opposite direction. I'm gonna start with the top layers and move down. And that's because the top layers here are particularly curly and they're kind of small. So I like to group them together. So I'm gonna start with this bunch that seems to be extra curly here. I have a weight to help weigh things down as the glue dries. So your glue choice here with cork, cork is pretty porous. And especially when it's curled like this, if you need it to lay flat, you need a glue that's gonna dry quickly. I'm using hot glue. Hot glue is maybe more permanent, and for these smaller pieces, totally fine with me. For the most part, these layers, they're all stacking nicely. I won't really have to do much, just the weight of them will hold them together. Probably this top zone I'll end up pinning together or using some screws on it to keep it from curling over like this, but definitely this pile needs some work. So that's what I'm gonna get started on. So you can see we've got this top layer here. The top contour fits like this, so I know when I place this contour where exactly it registers and where it needs to go. Hot glue dries very quickly, so it's actually really nice to use in that regard. So you can see with this, if I didn't have this piece to tell me exactly where it goes, I would have no idea how to align it in this direction. So with all this, I kind of dry fit it, get it close, line things up. Then I'm going to apply my glue. And in this particular case, I'm just applying it to the edges for the most part. So let's talk about some other adhesives you could use. You could use spray mount. Spray mount's nice for getting even coverage. And actually you can remove the contours after they've been mounted with spray mount. So I do like that for cork especially. You could use a double-sided tape. Oftentimes what I find with double-sided tape is that it's not quite sticky enough. So if you want to tack layers together, it works well for doing that. So you could use a hybrid between, say, a white glue and a double-sided tape. So the white glue would set more slowly. The double-sided tape would hold it while it's setting in place. The problem when you have porous materials like cork, if you have a white glue, which has a lot of water in it, you will absorb that water into the material and the material will oftentimes buckle and bubble. And you don't really want that. That's not a desirable feature. You could use glue sticks. I find that they're not quite tacky enough. You could use a Gorilla Glue. Gorilla Glue will require you to wet the surface. So again, not like a huge fan of that. Helps if you get it all the way out to the edge. I'm gonna press these layers together and then get them flat quick as you can. So we've got those pieces all glued together. A lot less curly than it was for sure. So you can see as long as I get this edge correct and I line up the back edge, everything should be in alignment. So for trees, I have a bunch of wooden dowels. I'm just gonna take them down to the chop saw and cut them to length, a variety of lengths, and then I'll show you how I plant them. So I've got my bucket full of different sized trees, and they're a variety of thicknesses. So I'm just gonna go ahead and start making these up. So if there's any inconsistencies on the end, just kind of sand that off. So the next step is, I just have these little dress pins. Some places call them silk pins, some places call them hat pins. Super cheap, this was like 97 cents, I think. So you're gonna grip the sharp end of the pin, you're gonna push the sharp end of the pin into the end of the wood dowel. And you wanna grip it close by to the end, and you're just gonna push it in like that, okay? So a handy tip here is to put a rare earth magnet on the edge of your pliers if they're not already magnetized, and this way you can pick up the pins really easily. Next step is to clip it off, and I usually leave about like a quarter of an inch, and to clip that off. When you're snipping off this tag end here, always hold on to it. If you don't, it could go flying across the room and seriously hurt somebody. When you clip it off, then you just have this little pin end here. So then when you're ready to plant your tree, you have the sharp end in the cork, push it in. Because the cork is self-healing, it's really easy to modify where the trees are, and if you need to remove some or add some, it's easy to do that without impacting the model base. So lots of different ways to do water. For this particular one, I thought I was just gonna default to the homosote, the gray of the homosote here, but I didn't really like the texture on the face of it, so I just swapped out a little piece of double-sided 5mm mylar and just slipped that in there. No gluing, not necessary. It just kind of lays there. So the next step here is to start designing. Can't wait. See you again next time. Cheers, my friends.